In August 1903, at the Zionist Congress at Basel, Max Nordau said, "Let me tell you the following words as if I were showing you the rungs of a ladder leading upward and upward. Herzl, the Zionist Congress, the English-Uganda proposition, the future World War, the Peace Conference, where with the help of England a free and Jewish Palestine will be created."
His Majesty's government view with favour the establishment of Palestine as a national home for the Jewish people and will use their best endeavours to facilitate the achievement of this object, it being clearly understood that nothing shall be done which may prejudice the civil and religious rights of existing non-Jewish communities in Palestine or the rights and political status enjoyed by Jews in any other country. I should be grateful if you would bring this declaration to the knowledge of the Zionist Federation. Yours, Arthur Balfour."
And here it is, the Balfour Declaration. What do you feel when you see it here?
I genuinely feel it's one of the most extraordinary moments in the history of the Jewish people. If you think it took 3,000 years to get to this. And then you say, how did this miracle happen? It was the most incredible piece of opportunism.
And so that letter by Lord Balfour of the British government to Lord Rothschild is a Zionist letter. And we know that it was opportunistic for the Jewish Zionists like the Rothschilds and other Jews, but it wasn't opportunistic for the Palestinians. And despite this letter promising that nothing shall be done which may prejudice the civil and religious rights of the existing non-Jewish communities in Palestine, the opposite happened because of the racist and religious beliefs of the Zionist Jews that they are God's chosen people. And so listen now to hear what the Israeli prime ministers over the years have said about the Palestinians.
They are firing at the tunnels.
Filming.
I keep filming. They are firing. It's at the tunnels.
Eight. Yet support her with Egypt.
All along, that if ground troops go in, then there will be casualties among the troops, and that's what's heightened the debate here between the part of the Israeli population who supported the air campaign to stop Hamas firing the rockets into Israel. And
Then, in 1917, things changed. The British conquered Palestine from the Turks. They legalized the Jewish national home idea with the Balfour Declaration in the same year.
Palestine became a special case because the British violated the provisions of the Mandate for Palestine, because they put the Balfour Declaration into the Palestine Mandate, you say. What did this mean? It meant that for Palestine, the wishes of the inhabitants, 90% Arab, would not be listened to, and they would not be developed for independence. It would be Jews, once they came in through immigration, you see, they would be allowed to develop. And so it's really with the Palestinian mandate and the violation of the mandatory provisions to give the Zionists the right to create a majority of Jews to create a Palestinian state that the real Palestinian is Zionist conflict begins, with very few illusions on both sides.
The Palestinians launched two popular uprisings against the Jews and the British blatant pro-Zionist policies. The first took place in 1929 and claimed hundreds of Palestinians and Jewish lives. The second, in 1936, was practically a small-scale war between the Palestinians and the British, who were also aided by the Zionists. It lasted for 3 years, and in the end, approximately 5,000 Palestinians died. The British also exiled the Palestinians' leadership and dismantled all Palestinians' paramilitary units. The Palestinians were left defenseless and leaderless.
Most of the Israeli commanders had studied the British reaction to the Palestinian revolt in 1936 and 1939, which became the manual book of what to do to the Palestinians in case of resistance. In fact, most of the atrocities you read about, and I'm sure most of you in this place know about it, most of the atrocities that you enlist as severe violations of human rights and civil rights in Palestine today, most of these violations were invented not by a Jewish Zionist mind, but by British mandatory authorities in the war against the Palestinians between 1936 to 1939. Examples: the idea that you demolish houses of people is a British invention. The idea that in order to make a search memorable to people, you destroy a house and then you move to the other house and then to the other house and then to the other house was an invention by British officers on the ground. The idea that you shoot people without warning them or you arrest them without trial, it's all from the reservoir of the mandatory anti-Arab measures in 1936 to 1939. But of course the Israelis added their own brutal and callous ideas as the occupation continued.
Then, in the 1940s, the cards turned. Following a string of British pro-Palestinian policies, the Zionists launched terrorist attacks on British personnel and facilities.
Violence continues to rule in Palestine. British soldiers seek bodies in the Department of Labor building at Chechnik, where a few minutes before, a blast had partially wrecked the edifice. Three policemen were blown to bits when they tried to remove an explosive-laden truck. Shaky walls are torn down.
After a bomb explosion caused by terrorists on the British headquarters at Jerusalem, one entire corner of the King David Hotel, a building of 7 stories, was razed to the ground. The stone floors were cut.
88 innocent people died, and a good deal of the British high command was wiped out.
And so, after the British army helped the Zionist Jews establish their terrorist state there in Palestine, they then became subject to the terror of the Jews. And when they don't get their own way, this is what they do. They become violent. and the British left Palestine after that. And so then the Jews turned their attention to setting up the United Nations so that they could partition Palestine and take over Palestine. And of course, the United Nations was set up by the Rockefellers. And then today, of course, Palestine, the Jewish state, is 80% owned by the Rothschilds. And so let's have a look now at the genocide in Palestine that the Jews caused with their terror tactics.
Yeah. Abstain.
The resolution of the Duck Committee for Palestine was adopted by 33 votes, 13 against, 10 abstentions.
Why would the UN be so blatantly pro-Zionist? Do not underestimate the power of guilt. Anyone heard of the Holocaust? The UN sought to compensate the Jews over the deaths of 6 million Jews in World War II. Murdered by the Germans. And they decided that the Palestinians should pay for it. Makes perfect sense. However, this amount of land, more than half of Palestine, was still not enough for the Zionists. David Ben-Gurion, the leader of the Zionist movement in Palestine, wrote in 1937, "The Arabs will have to go. But one needs an opportune moment for making it happen, such as a war." The Palestinians had no desire to fight the Zionists or start a war. They were used to living under different sovereigns for hundreds of years: Egyptians, Turks, British, and now the Zionists. In 1948, Ben-Gurion tells the Jewish agency executives, "I believe that the majority of the Palestinian masses accept the partition as fait accompli and do not believe it is possible to overcome or reject it. The decisive majority of them do not want to fight us." Towards the end of 1947, the Zionist leadership came together and drew Plan Dalit. Plan Dalit was about securing the borders of Israel by cleansing, expelling, and destroying Palestinian towns, villages, and urban neighborhoods. The plan was implemented by the Zionist armed forces.
And finally, in March, they began a push to ensure their control of areas that would become Israel under the partition. And as that happened, you began to get many more Palestinian Arabs fleeing, particularly after a massacre at a place called Deir Yassin, although people now think it was probably somewhat over 100, but not 200. But Begin and the Irgun and the Stern gang, Yitzhak Shamir was part of that. There was a combined attack in this Palestinian village that massacred many people. And the Palestinians did carry out a retaliatory raid, killing about 70 Jewish doctors on the road to Jerusalem shortly thereafterwards. But after that, you had mobile radio bands the Begin put into play, threatening more Deir Yassins if the Arabs didn't flee. In other words, you'll be massacred just like Deir Yassin. So it became part of the propaganda.
Between the 30th of March and 15th of May, 1948, 200 villages were occupied and their inhabitants expelled. In some villages, such as Deir Yassin and Ain al-Zaytun, horrible massacres were perpetrated. the towns of Tiberias, Haifa, Tzfat, Beisan, Jaffa, and Acre fell into Zionist hands. As a result, more than 250,000 Palestinians were expelled.